I'd like to invite our second speaker, Ronalee Zarate-Bayani. Ronalee is the head of global integrated marketing communications and digital advancement at the Hershey Company, where she committed to establishing modern marketing excellence, creating compelling communications, and building enhanced digital capabilities. Prior to Hershey, Ronalee worked at Visa, where she was instrumental in forming a new internal marketing consulting group based on cultural strategy and social insights. Prior to Visa, Ronalee also worked at Taco Bell, where she led the digital team through a marketing transformation. So before I invite Ronalee on stage, I'd just like to mention that there is a little Hershey chocolate item in each of your conference bags. So while you're enjoying the talk, feel free to dive into the chocolate indulgence. So welcome.
Good afternoon. Let's talk about marketing in a digital world and what it means for a marketer to make sense of all the madness. So long gone are the days where marketers could lean on tried and true marketing practices that stemmed from, pushing out controlled and well-crafted content. Right? Those days are gone. We live in a world where the world is moving faster than we as marketers can perfect our marketing models. And why is that? Well, let's take a look at what's happening all around us. Technological advances have fundamentally disrupted consumer behavior. And with that disruption comes a change in consumer expectations, expectations of themselves, of how they live their lives, and of all the things around them, especially brands. Consumers today now live in moments, and these moments define their experiences, and these experiences shape their memories, and these memories and memory structures ultimately drive their behavior. It is amidst this landscape where they are inundated with constant stimuli and activity that we have to break through as marketers. And why is that? Well, the world is literally at our fingertips. With a few swipes, with a few taps, you could access just about anything you want to access in this world. 9 out of 10 millennials start and end their day with their mobile device. And throughout the day, we're checking our phone on average over 150 times a day. About a third of us are really concerned and anxious when our phone is not by our side. This is the backdrop in the world that we live in. All day long, we are uncovering and discovering experiences, information, products, entertainment. We are no longer setting aside time to sit down and find these things. Instead, we are doing it throughout our everyday task, in the middle of our task. We're constantly on the go, we're multitasking all day long, and it is amidst this backdrop that we as marketers have to earn our consumers' most precious asset, one that is dwindling, and that is their attention. On average, consumers now have the attention span less than that of a goldfish. And yet we are inundated with much more stimuli than we ever were before. Where are they spending their time? Well, there's an increasing amount of time spent on more and more media. But the type of media that they're spending on is very different than they did before. As they're spending less time on traditional media like linear TV, they're increasing their time on digital media, and this will only increase month over month, year over year. Now, this is exciting for a marketer in the sense that you have so many more ways to engage your consumer and to meet your consumer with your brand. At the same time, it is incredibly daunting because this is a highly fragmented world. It is a world that is ever evolving and ever changing. It is a world that is disrupting itself on a daily basis. And if you think about it, This is a world where we as brands are not only competing with other brands for the content that we produce out there, for the attention of our consumers. We are competing with all the content that is out there. Content in this world is democratized. I am a content producer. My mother is a content producer. My neighbor is a content producer. As I sit here and talk to you, some of you are looking at your phone. You're reading a text, a tweet, and an email. And guess what? That is content that is consuming your attention, the little that you have to give. That is what we have to break through. So, our traditional marketing model is gone. Technology has fundamentally disrupted it. And so we as marketers can either embrace the complexity that exists all around us and find a way to leverage it to our competitive advantage, or we'll find ourselves obsolete. The marketer today cannot stay on top of everything, so they have to think about the world differently. The marketer today that is going to win in tomorrow has to transform their mindset into more of a modern-day marketing alchemist. In the past, the marketer perfected their craft through repetition and experience. And over time, they got better and better at the nuances. Today, the world is moving faster than we can. And so the best that we can do is learn how to pull in the right ingredients at the right time, the right experts, and put them into this magic mix within the right sequence in order to create that marketing magic that will draw your consumers to your brand. Now, for those of us that have grown up in this craft, the good news is that you don't have to throw the baby out with the bathwater. The fundamentals of marketing still hold true. You've got to have an ownable brand strategy, one that distinguishes you from your competitors in the hearts and minds of your consumer. And you've got to have consumer-centric insights. The difference today is that those insights have to be married with the cultural zeitgeist. You have to marry that with the brand truths. And you have to bridge the two with the big idea. But today, that big idea manifests itself in a very different way. It now has to manifest itself in a series of relevant expressions, meaningful experiences, and compelling engagement. Because today, we can no longer craft our story in totality and push it out in its perfect form in the hopes that we can disrupt our consumer, get their attention, and have them consume our story from beginning to end. Now the consumer is taking part of developing that brand story. And so what do we as marketers have to do to enable them to develop the story that makes sense so that our brand can fit into their lives? We at the Hershey Company are determined to continue to win the hearts and minds of our consumers today and for years on out. And so we've transformed our marketing model over the last 2 years. And now we have to rethink what marketing is about in this digital age. And one of the things that we have to think about in terms of overlaying on top of the marketing fundamentals is that we've got to tell stories through micro moments, because that's all we have with our consumers. And so what does that mean? Brand building in the digital age is about modern storytelling. And so when you overlay the fundamentals with three key principles, connect their way, communicate from culture and context, and planning for agility, then you can start to engage in modern storytelling. So let's break this down and look at each. Connect their way. What does this mean? This means understanding what it is your consumers are doing and where they're doing it. And then it means thinking about how you show up as a brand so that you're pulling them into your content versus disrupting them and pushing it out. How do you natively show up in a way that is meaningful to the experience that they're already doing? With one of our brands, Jolly Rancher, we fundamentally shifted how we went to market with this brand. And one of the things that we did is focus on these quick, relatable stories. And so let's take a look at what we did with this brand.
After years of decline, Jolly Rancher had to connect with a new generation in a new era of communication. We developed a new model that revolutionized the brand's voice and communication strategy. The idea was powerfully simple. Remind today's youth to keep on sucking with its animated fruit game full of empathy and edge. And it was a creative and a media idea that allowed us to infiltrate their life, connecting with them every day, living on every platform, resulting in over 3,000 pieces of content produced in-house over 12 months. We owned their social conversations about their sucky daily grind, giving them much-needed LOLs. And we created bespoke content around media-specific opportunities to own suck for a larger audience. So thanks to the Jolly Rancher Fruit Gang, more people are sucking every day. And as long as there are things in life that suck, Jolly Rancher has your back.
The second thing you have to think about is to communicate from culture and context. In the past, you could really root yourself and think about the brand and think about what's at the heart of the consumer. And connect the two and come up with a great campaign, and you could somehow connect the dots between your consumer and your brand. Today, you've got to look not only at the consumer-centered insights, but you've got to look at cultural insights. You've got to look at contextual insights. You've got to think about what they're doing when they encounter your brand. And so, as I mentioned, our brand is about all the different experiences that they put together in their minds. That is the story of our brand. So as we think about how we want to communicate and engage our consumers, we have to put ourselves in their mindset and say, when they encounter us, what do they want to know? Where do they want to go? What do they want to make? What do they want to buy? And where do they want to play? And then what role do we as a brand have to play in that in order to add value to that experience and that endeavor? One example where we brought this thinking to life was a simple activation that we did with the Kisses brand in the Say It With a Kiss campaign on Snapchat. And when we were thinking about what to do with the brand, we're thinking about various cultural moments where consumers can connect with one another, because that's at the heart of Kisses. And one cultural moment that we thought of was the moment when you kiss someone at midnight. Now, if you think about culture, that is a very relatable cultural moment. And so if you think about what brand could fit in that, what more than a brand like Kisses, who has that name and the namesake? However, that's culture. Now let's overlay context. And once you overlay context, you realize there's no way you should show up at midnight. Why? Because they don't care about any brand at that time. And if you did show up and someone noticed you, you're probably only going to annoy them. So we had to think about, what do they do before and after? Well, they're sharing. They're sharing their excitement, their anticipation, and then their celebrations. And how are they sharing? They're sharing via their mobile device, through an image, through a video, and they're sharing it on platforms like Snapchat. And so we leverage what the platform had to give with geofencing, geotargeting, and geofiltering, because midnight happens at different times throughout the country. And so if you leverage that data and that technology and marry it with what's happening in culture and context and the brand, here's a simple activation that we brought to life where we added value to the experience that our consumers were already doing. Very relevant filters that they're already accessing, because that's what they do on this platform during those times. So let's talk about the third pillar, planning for agility. As a marketer, you've got to plan for most things, because that gives you capacity to then take advantage of the things that you can't plan for. And let me tell you, the ability to take advantage of the things you can't plan for are those diamonds in the rough that can really add great value to your brand. So I'm going to share a couple examples where we really brought this to life. One of them is the Reese's All Trees Are Beautiful case study. So a little over a year ago, we put out our Reese's trees. We do this every year. And at the time, a lot of consumers were complaining in social media. And they were saying, wow, these trees kind of don't look like trees at all. They kind of look like turd. Well, that got picked up in media. It got loud. And as a company, you could do one of many things. You could respond with traditional corporate speak. You could get defensive. You could hide and do nothing. Instead, what we decided to do was harness this energy and leverage our fans to turn it in our favor. As a result, we had week over week sales and share growth for this brand. We also used the idea as a foundation for our campaign for 2016, and we won numerous industry awards, including the illustrious Can Lion. So let's take a look at what this is all about.
That's not even close to a tree.
The problem with these candies shaped like trees, they're not.
A few months later, we had another opportunity come our way. A Kansas State University student got his car broken into. And when he came back to his car, he found a note written on a napkin. And that note said, "Saw Kit Kats in your cup holder. I love Kit Kats. I checked your door and it was unlocked. Didn't take anything except the Kit Kat. I'm sorry and hungry." As you can imagine, that spread like wildfire, and it went pretty viral. And so we acted very quickly. We responded and said, "Who does that?" And very quickly, we filled his car with thousands of Kit Kat. Now, he tweeted about it, he posted about it, and guess what? It got picked up by media. We had over 1,200 media placements. We had over 700 million impressions. And when we did the math on that, it was roughly the equivalent of us buying $8 to $10 million of TV media. The ROI on that was off the chart. There's no way you can plan for that. The best you can do is plan to be ready to take advantage of that and use that and harness brand love in order to build your brand. Another way where we actually exercise agility is through personalization. Because if you think about that experience that they have, that moment that they get in contact with your brand, they're so few. And so you have to make them count. And so one of the ways that we do that is to personalize the experience. So when we launched the new Kit Kat campaign with Chance the Rapper, an award-winning artist, we did customized wrappers in social media. And they spread that like gangbusters. As I already shared with you earlier, for JR, we do bespoke content all the time. This is the modern day way of marketing. So if you bring that all together, we have one activation that we recently did that kind of brings us all to life. We recently launched a new product innovation for the Hershey franchise called Cookie Layer Crunch. And we had a great marketing plan, well-crafted, well-thought-through. And as we were about ready to launch, we realized, you know what? We could probably do a pre-launch because we're getting the product out to market already. Now, we didn't have mass distribution before we were ready to do our major launch. And so we went to digital and launched that way so that we could be targeted. And here's an example of that experience.
This is the story of Hershey's Cookie Layer Crunch. Do something fast and big on the largest social media platforms, where mass audiences can now be reached and targeted precisely. The team also knew that a simple Facebook post would not be enough. They needed an innovative approach to their communications to tease, launch, and sustain momentum. And what better way to do all of this for Cookie Layer Crunch then on National Cookie Day, December 4th. The team teased the new product launch via Facebook and Twitter, culminating in a Facebook Live event filmed right here in Hershey, Pennsylvania.
Here it is, Hershey's Cookie Layer Crunch!
Along with the event, Hershey's owned the National Cookie Day trend on Twitter, encouraging consumers to reimagine cookies and leveraging influencers to promote the day and Cookie Layer Crunch's induction into the extended cookie family. The results were also pretty crunch-tacular. The learnings from the success of this new model will help Hershey deliver new product experiences to retail partners faster, with more precision, and without having to wait for traditional mass media support.
Now, no matter how creative you get with your storytelling, in this day and age, you will find yourself at a disadvantage if you don't enhance that creativity with data and technology. This is going to be the key competitive advantage for today and going forward. Because there's so many advances out there. There's so much happening with regard to technology. Technology is disrupting technology on a daily basis. And yes, it is a convoluted, complex landscape. But we've got to figure it out. Because if you don't, your competitors will. And this is the one space where you can draw a tremendous amount of insights that can distinguish yourself, where you can understand your consumer and you could more clearly connect the dots. We've got to find the right ecosystem of the yin and yang of data and creativity, of our agency partners and our technology partners, and we've got to bring that right mix together. And for every brand, for every category, for every company, that's going to be different. But the thing that will remain the same is that data and technology is here to stay. And you've got to leverage it to your advantage. And so one of the things that we did where we brought this to life was when we launched the Reese's Pieces Cups, a new product innovation for the Reese's franchise. And what ended up happening was that it actually leaked to the public before we were ready to talk about it. And so we looked at the data and we said, what are consumers saying? How are they feeling? What are they doing? And we used that data to actually create the Cup Fusion campaign. And what we ended up doing was fueling that ember, pouring some gasoline on it, and sparking a huge flame so that the anticipation that was out there, we made bigger, to the point where we actually tripled our sales forecast unexpectedly. And we knew that we wouldn't get ubiquitous distribution right away. And so when we started to go out there, we used data to find the right consumer at the right moment and let them know the right place to actually get the product, because the last thing you want to do is disappoint your consumers. But this really drove sales for us. And again, it was about marrying the unexpected, marrying creativity, marrying data, and bringing that all together for that modern-day marketing alchemist. No matter how well you've perfected your marketing model, you've got to constantly challenge yourself and experiment forward. Because what got you here today, what got you to win, is not what is going to get you to win tomorrow. And so you've got to learn forward and evolve quickly. You've got to understand where your consumers are going and what they are doing wherever it is they are going, and more importantly, why they are doing what they are doing where they are going. That is the magic. That is the secret sauce. And so at the Hershey Company, we're constantly experimenting. And so one example of this was when we launched the Kit Kat campaign with Chance the Rapper. Well, Chance the Rapper actually sang our Kit Kat jingle in his own way. And we wanted to involve consumers in the experience. And so we played with a platform called Musical.ly. For those of you that don't know this, your kids will probably know because it is very popular with the youth. And it is a platform that marries social media and music. And so here's an example of the launch spot of what Chance the Rapper did and then what our consumers did on the Musical.ly platform.
Chance the Rapper break.
Break me off a piece of that Kit Kat bar.
We're both Chance the Rapper.
No, I get it.
Have a break. Have a Kit Kat.
Give me a break. Just give me a break.
engaging in this experience, we allowed our consumers to be part of the storytelling and to be part of the sharing and to bring authenticity into that story that we were telling. Another example where we experimented forward is with partnering with Twitch and the Jolly Rancher brand. Now, for the Jolly Rancher target, gaming over-indexes tremendously. And so we thought, what better way to connect with our consumers than to be a part of the gaming experience? And Twitch is a platform that's all about gaming. But what we didn't want to do was just buy an ad and put a spot. We wanted to be part of the experience and provide some value to the consumer. So let's take a look at the unique experience we did.
In fall 2016, Hershey gave us the opportunity to explore a digitally innovative test and learn program that could cost effectively deliver learnings for the wider company. We were tasked with four key objectives: find new ways to engage audiences, be relevant in consumers' lives, extend brand experiences to new places, create conversation through digital innovation. Gaming was an untapped space with a lot of potential. It's a long-lasting, hands-free usage occasion that not only over-indexes with our target, but also exposes us to a much broader audience, making it the perfect fit for Jolly Rancher. Losing in a video game sucks, and it's exactly the sort of moment Jolly Rancher can be your empathetic ally in. Working together, Anomaly and UM partnered with Twitch to tap into their network of influential gamers and create a brand-driven live streaming event. Weekly check-ins, open communication, and collaborative ideation sessions set us up for success.
No matter how much you experiment, no matter how much you test, if you don't have a way to bring those learnings back into the system, it doesn't matter. Because what you need is to take all those failures and make sure that other folks in the company know about it so that they don't repeat it. And take those wins and those learnings and infiltrate it back into your marketing system so that other folks can tap into it, leverage it, and apply it and drive the business at scale. I think this is a big mistake that a lot of folks do, is in our worlds where we are in large companies, a lot of learning's happening in silos. And we don't have the systems to feed them back into the rest of the organization. This is a key competitive advantage for winning in the digital age because it allows the rest of the organization to be much more agile and take advantage of opportunities that work. And so as we think about what it means to make sense of the madness, there's five key things to think about. You've got to know how culture and technology are driving consumer behaviors and changing their expectations. You've got to stay on top of the trends. Don't lose sight of the marketing fundamentals. Now, at the same time, don't hold it as gospel. It is the start, the beginning of which you layer on much more. You've got to build your brand through a series of micro moments because sometimes that's all you have. And then you've got to use data as your key competitive advantage because if you don't, your competitors will. Lastly, you've got to challenge yourself over and over again, because if you're winning today and you apply that over and over again, it will quickly become obsolete and someone else will win tomorrow. So my challenge to you is to make marketing magic and transform into marketing alchemist, because the journey to winning the hearts and minds of your consumers starts with you and your ability to make sense of the madness.
Hi, thanks so much for coming today. That was great. So I'm a student here at SOM, and I guess one of the questions that I have is around how you organize around this kind of communication when something like this has to happen so quickly. Like, how are you structuring internally so that you can figure out, like, what's the right message? Are we okay with putting this message out there, putting it together, and getting it out there as quickly as you are doing that? Because it seems like that's an area where brands are still struggling a lot.
Mm-hmm. There's two ways to approach it. One, you can have a dedicated team that's just solely responsible for real time. that's generally harder to sell into an organization to dedicate that many resources. So what we actually do is what we call a smart process, social media response team. And we have someone from PR, we have someone from brand, we have someone from the social insights, we have one person from the creative agency and one person from the media agency. And when something comes up and someone identifies something, an alert goes out. And everyone is trained to know that when that alert goes out, they stop, they pay attention, and they huddle. And so we quickly come up with a game plan. I also have someone on my team that knows kind of the legal parameters inside and out. And so they've been dubbed as okay to approve material to get out. So that allows us to be a lot more nimble.
My question is very related. So could you elaborate on how your organizational structure has changed before and after in terms of the new digital teams being set up compared to what it was before? So who reports to whom, how many more people you have, and so on and so forth.
That's a lot. So I guess what I would say is, in the past, when I first joined, we had a very traditional marketing model, very TV-centric. And so digital was kind of this thing off to the side. As we went through this transformation, I was pushing to put digital kind of at the center of our marketing. And you really had to, because if you don't, then it's still something of an afterthought. We evolved our structure. And so we grew our digital center of excellence and actually evolved it to an integrated marketing communication center of excellence. My team then worked with the brand leadership, and we redefined our processes. We redefined how we engage with one another. We actually built out a very different agency ecosystem, and then we brought in a lot of digital partners. So it was a multi-pronged effort in order to transform from where we were to where we are today. But right now, my team really focuses on the communications, the engagement, and we work with brands who are more general managers in the CPG space, so that when they are focused on the communication, we're right with them by their side. Okay.
What do you see the future of your relationships with your agencies? I mean, you're seeing this trend in bringing stuff in-house and develop these centers of excellence in terms of analytics, creative directors even coming in-house, media, and using data. Outsourcing all that and giving that to your agencies is a bit of a challenge. And the turnover that happens in agencies as well. Do you see the future of that as bringing more in-house to the Hershey Company or relying more on your agencies? Or what do you see that structure like?
I see our agencies more as an extension of our team. And so we actually thought about whether you bring that in-house, whether you leave it out there. And the reality is, if you brought it in-house, it's very hard to maintain the being current, right? Because you're not inundated with it all the time. Whereas the agencies have access to multiple clients, they're always in that space. And so what we found right now, that the best partnership is really being a true partner and being a part of the decision making that goes into the activations that the agencies are doing, versus before it was more of a black box, whereas like, here's the brief, off you go, come back. Now we're part of that. We're having dialogue. We're involved in the decision making. We set the principles and the parameters for the decision making. So it's more about structuring how we work together versus restructuring the agency and the in-house relationship. Okay, thank you.